welcome to our service of Holy Communion on this, the first Sunday of Lent. I sound extremely loud. Just to say that being the season of Lent, there are a number of things happening around our benefice and indeed around our deanery. There you go. And by that I mean, tonight is the first of our deanery evening services. We're at Eaton Soapen at 6 o'clock, so if you'd like to come join us for that, you'd be most welcome. That's the first, and then next Sunday evening we're at Biggleswade. I won't give too many, otherwise it's all confusing. So that's Eaton Soapen tonight, 6 o'clock. I'm sure it'll be a different style of worship to what we're used to, but I'm sure we'll still be able to worship God, even if it's in a different way. Our Lent course is starting this coming week. If you haven't signed up for it already, there is an afternoon session which is taking place at Great Barford Church at 2:30 on Wednesday afternoon. Or if you have signed up for the evening session, that's here in Roxton at 7:30 this coming Friday. So it's either Wednesday at Great Barford, 2:30, or here at Roxton at 7:30 on Friday evening. We had a great time eating pancakes on Tuesday, and in a way that continues, but not pancakes. We got our Lent lunches beginning on Tuesday. What time did they start?
It's 12 o'clock.
12 o'clock, 12 noon. There you go. Come have a Lent lunch here on Tuesday lunchtime. So please do come support if you are able to, and I'm sure it'll be the most wonderful soup and bread and cheese and things like that.
I think it's Yvonne this week, so it will be delicious.
Right? Yeah. Yvonne's the chef this week. So there'll be hordes of people coming. We'll have to sit out here in the pews, I'm sure, because there won't be any room anywhere else. So that's Tuesday lunchtime, 12 noon, beginning of our lunches. Is there anything else? I can't think of anything else on the top of my head. So we're going to begin our service by singing hymn number 145, 40 days and 40 nights, 145.
Nice.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As I so often do, I've forgotten one announcement. On Friday, we had our World Day of Prayer service at Great Barford on Friday afternoon. And if you weren't able to attend, then there are three or four of the service booklets at the back of the church. So if you'd like to take one and have a look, you'd be most welcome to do that. It was a wonderful service. We were able to reflect upon our nation as well as the world in our prayer. And we sang some lovely songs and hymns too. So please do take one. There's three or four copies there. I'll put this one at the back, which will make four. And please do take one and read it if you so wish. So we move on to the prayer of preparation, which we say together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please sit. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first command is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other command greater than these. And these two commandments have all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord, who is full of compassion, and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. So we make our confession together as we say: Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. In this season of Lent, we use the key. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who is all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So the collect for today, the first Sunday of Lent. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ fasted 40 days in the wilderness and was tempted as we are, yet without sin, give us grace to discipline ourselves in obedience to your Spirit. And as you know our weakness, so may we know your power to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. So we hear our first two readings.
The first reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 26, verses 1 to 11. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it. You shall take some of the first of the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket, and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at the time, and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God, and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you in your house." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from Romans chapter 10, verses 8b to 13. "What does the scripture say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, and the same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stand and sing the gradual hymn 312. Lord Jesus, think on me. 312. Thank you. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan, and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Do you all read a weekly comic? Who has a weekly comic? Anyone?
No.
Oh, gone. Well, those days, have they? That would be no one. That would be awesome. Okay. Some people consider Jesus a superhero. You know the ones I'm talking about. You know, let me think. Batman, or you know, some of the Avengers. Perhaps not the Avengers that you're thinking of. You know, with Patrick Mindy and they think of Jesus, well, he's got this wonderful power. We see it in his miracles. He heals people. He, even the winds and the waves obey him. We had that reading the other week, didn't we? Well, what power Jesus has. He has the power to change Jesus' life. So he must be a superhero, you know, like Superman. You know, when the train's going over the cliff and he comes along and zaps it and it stays up on the top of the cliff and it doesn't fall down into the sea. Or whatever it might be. You know the sort of thing I'm talking about. The films you watch and all that sort of stuff. I bet you sneak off to the cinema and watch those, don't you? I bet you do, yeah. Jesus is not a superhero in that way. He's not like Superman, a reporter, 1 minute and then changes into some sort of superhero to save the world. Yes, Jesus can save the world, but not in that way. In any way, Jesus shows his humanness through the whole of his earthly ministry. Every now and again, he just reminds them that, actually, I'm a bit like you. And not least at the beginning of his ministry. And all those things, as we look back to Christmas even, and his birth as a baby in a stable, cold and drafty as we sing. He wasn't born in some great palace. And here is one of those occasions. For Jesus is tempted by the devil, just as we are. And he's able to reject what those temptations that the devil puts in his way. It shows in a way the strength of his human character. He doesn't now, you know, don't get me wrong on this bit, but he doesn't think, well, here's the devil, let's get rid of him, zaps him with some sort of ray or something and gets him out of the way. What does Jesus do? He answers with words of scripture. And we're going to examine those three temptations just a little bit more in detail in a moment or two. And we may ask, well, why three temptations? Well, it says at the end there that when the devil had finished all of his tests, he departed from him, or whatever words we want to use. The devil went away. He realized that he'd lost the argument. Jesus was able, through the words of Scripture, to answer those temptations. I want to put those three temptations into three categories. Those three temptations. To put a bit of a title to each of them, if you like. That first temptation I'm going to call a temptation of the material. The temptation of the material. The devil says to Jesus, look, you see all these stones lying around here in the wilderness? You could turn those into bread. You could turn those into bread. You've got all these days, 40 days, and you're feeling famished. It says so there in the scripture. Jesus was famished after all we would want, be. I'm famished after one day, and I'm 40. How easy would it have been for Jesus to say, okay, I'll do it, and turn the stones into bread? Now, we've seen through the stories of the Old Testament when the people of Israel were going through the desert, and God provided manna for them. And it would have been easy for Jesus to do that. But what does Jesus say? He says, man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by bread alone. It doesn't mean to say that God doesn't understand that we're human, we need to fill up our stomachs to give us physical strength. Of course we do. God understands that. Jesus here is talking about the mental and spiritual strength of us. And God's word is the answer. To be fed by the scriptures and not the ways of the world. To live as God intended, as we were created. The temptation of the material. You can have material things, you can have the bread. Second, I'm going to call the second one the temptation of compromise. Compromise. What do I mean by compromise? Well, it's simple, really. It's simple. It's compromising the commands, the directions and inspiration we receive through the Holy Spirit. Compromise that the devil shows Jesus. He says, well, if only you would worship me instead of your heavenly Father, things will be okay. It won't make any difference. And of course, it takes us back to the commandments, doesn't it? You shall worship no other gods but me. That's what God commanded. That's what the people of Israel were living by. Those commands are all important. And there are to be no compromises as disciples of Jesus Christ. I said recently that we cannot pick and choose which of God's commands we follow. This happens a lot. It happens within the church itself sometimes. You know, we pick, oh, that's a good one, that's an easy one to follow, we'll just do that one there. And that, oh, that's a bit difficult, so we'll forget that. Don't need to follow that. We can't cherry pick what we want to follow in God's commands. We can't do that in our faith. It's all or nothing. A bit like sitting on the fence. You can't sit on the fence. You're either one side or you're the other. You can't sit on the spiky fence and think, well, I'm okay here because I'll do a bit of that. Well, you know, it doesn't work like that. There ought to be no compromises. That's what the devil tries to do to Jesus here. You know, just compromise. Don't worship your Heavenly Father. Worship me. It's a sort of compromise in his faith, as we would say. The temptation of the material. The temptation of compromise. I'm going to call the final one, the third one, the temptation of sensationalism. Difficult word to say. Sensationalism. I think we've become rather dull a little bit to the sensationalism of the media. You know, what we read in our newspapers, what we see on our television sets, what we get on Facebook and all those other forms of interacting with others, those forms of media. You know, it seems to me that if there's a tiny hint that somebody in authority has done something wrong, or there's a celebrity that's done something wonderful, then it's splashed all over the front pages. It's across our TVs, the news. It seems to me that they get it all wrong on the news sometimes, because some of the things that lead on the news, on our TV sets, is all wrong. There are more important things in the world than what some celebrity has done. It's blown out of all proportion. It's sensationalized in how it's presented to us. Of course, at the end of the day, the papers just start for the money. We'll sell more copies, they'll have more subscribers online. So the profits will go up. And they'll get a pound back, and the directors will get £50,000 pay reward or something. Jesus is not like that. He's not sensational. Can you imagine if the newspapers today were reporting, if Jesus had thrown himself off the top of the temple like the devil wanted him to, what the headlines would be? Jesus saved by the angels at the last second before he hits the ground. It'd be everywhere, wouldn't it? That's not our Jesus. That's not our Lord Jesus. And again, he answers the devil with words from Scripture. Words from Scripture. There's a lot of people that follow Jesus as we read time after time. Now, be it the 4,000, the 5,000, or whatever it might be. They wanted to see what Jesus was going to do next. They wanted to hear what words he was going to speak, with what authority he was going to speak. Jesus doesn't just zap and say, let's put that right. He doesn't zap away and put all the wrong things right. It's not like Superman or any of the other superheroes that we see in our comics or films or whatever it might be. Because God allows us to choose. To choose the way we follow. Material, compromise, sensationalist. As we work our way through this season of Lent, we need to be aware of the ways that the devil will tempt us away from our faith and belief in Jesus Christ. And Jesus is an example to us as we read this passage of Scripture. For we need to defend ourselves against the attack of the devil. And I hope that our faith is strong enough to protect us from whatever he might throw at us. And our strength is through our study, through our reading of God's word. It's the strength, true faith that we have. Sometimes we think, well, you know, the devil will tempt us when we were at our most vulnerable, our weakest point. And I suppose in a way we have an example of that, because as we heard from that scripture reading, Jesus was famished after those 40 days of nothing to eat, as we all would be. And I think, you know, the devil looked at and thought, he's going to be weak now. This is the moment I should go and tempt him. Because he's going to be weak from hunger. Also, the devil might attack when we're at our strongest in our faith. Just place something in our way that might just lure us away from following what he commands. So we have to be aware. We have to be alert to what the devil might throw at us. Whether we're feeling vulnerable or not. He will come and try and distract us, to lure us away from our faith. To take us away from our loving Lord Jesus Christ. So if I was to put in a nutshell what I was saying this morning, it would be two words. Be aware. Be aware. And may the strength of your faith protect you. As we believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, as we are soon to celebrate his resurrection, his power that overcame death and sin and the devil. Be aware. Amen. You think on those words, I invite you now to stand if you are able as we say the creed together. We believe in
today's response will be, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, would you say, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you call us to worship today to remind us that Jesus refused the temptation to worship the evil one, but rather than receive the glorious kingdoms of his world. He endured first the time in the wilderness, and ultimately the pain and suffering of the cross. Help us during our Lenten journey to fix our eyes on him and daily pick up our own crosses. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Father, we pray for all of our Lent activities here in this benefice, and for all the special services and those preparing, presenting and assisting. May they all lead us together in our churches to a holy Easter and a joyful celebration of the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, help all who govern and rule our nation today, and resist the temptation to use evil, violent and corrupt ways to bring about their personal desires, rather than ruling with justice, mercy and benevolence. We commend to you today the people of Ukraine. We condemn the actions of Russia in their attempt to take over power, and we ask you, Father, to protect those who are suffering and to help to bring about a speedy, victorious outcome for all those being oppressed at this time. Lord, in your mercy, loving God, may we demonstrate the joy of our Christian faith to all our family, friends and neighbours. We pray that those who have not yet come to know you, love you and to hear your word, open their hearts and minds to the wonders of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Merciful God, friend of those in need, your Son Jesus can free us from our burdens and heal our bodies and spirits. We pray for those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and the world. We pray too for those suffering from addiction of any kind, and ask that you help them to put the temptation of Satan and the world behind them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for all those who have died, especially those who encourage us in our faith by their example. As we pray for them, may they in turn continue to pray for us, that we may stay true to our faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Faithful God, you have taught us to overcome our sins by prayer, fasting, the works of mercy, when during the coming weeks of Lent we are discouraged by our weakness. Give us confidence in your love to help us through the glories of Easter. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son,
and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Please would you stand for the peace. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So we offer one another a sign of God's peace as we wave to each other. So we sing our offertory hymn 261, Jesu, lover of my soul, 261.
Jesus, lover.
Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and all your own do we give you. Amen. Let's use Eucharistic Prayer E, which you'll find on page 10. And after the opening responses, there is a special preface for this season of Lent. That's Eucharistic Prayer E, page 10, with a special preface after the opening responses. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give you thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son. For in these 40 days you lead us into the desert of repentance. Through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline, you may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. Through prayer to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please be seated. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. As we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day, when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. We come to the Lord's Prayer. We're going to use the right-hand version of the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. break this bread, to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, heir of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but let me say the word, and I shall be healed. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up and come to your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so that we be flesh to your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to the drink his wine, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood.
Thank you.
Lord God, you have renewed us with the living bread from heaven. By it you nourish our faith, increase our hope, and strengthen our love. Teach us always to hunger for him who is the true and living bread, and enable us to live by every word that proceeds out of your mouth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us through the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please would you stand for the blessing and dismissal before we sing our final hymn. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross, and follow him. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Go in peace, to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
So we sing our final hymn, 204. He is Lord, he is Lord, he is risen from the dead, and he is Lord, 204. Souls of the faithful departed, by the mercy of God, rest in peace.